the preaching of God's word this morning, please open your Bibles to Psalm 130. Psalm 130, if you need the Pew Bible, that'll be found on page 658. Psalm 130 is one of those blessed psalms of ascent, one of the psalms that Israel would have recited and sung together as families and as clans as they made their way up to Jerusalem, that they may meet with the Lord and find grace at his hands yet again. Let's pray together as we open God's word together. Oh Lord, we thank you for the Holy Scripture. We thank you that you've given us your word, and that by it you speak to the very heart and mind of man. Thank you that your word, O Lord, is true in every part. It is impossible for you to lie, to deceive, to lead astray, to speak half-truths. It is impossible for you, O Lord, to do anything but to be true and speak the truth. And we thank you for your infinite, O Lord, and perfect knowledge of the heart and mind of every man. And that by your Spirit, who is Spirit, you are able to bring the message of truth home to every heart. And Father, we pray that you would do that this morning. Let not a single soul leave this place without being touched by your grace today. And may this be the tool and the instrument in your Spirit's hand to do that work. Be merciful among us, O God, and bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 130, this is the word of God. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchman for the morning, more than the watchman for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Amen. Thus saith the Lord. Well, beloved, Psalm 130, as you can tell from the reading, it presents the case of a soul entangled in the depths of conscience and ready to be overwhelmed by the guilt of sin. A soul whose only complaint is his sin and whose only hope is in the God who forgives sinners. And it's as such that this psalm invites all of us today. It's as such this psalm meets with us. It's a psalm of ascent. It's applicable to all people at all times. It's applicable in every situation. And it invites us today, you and me, to sit no longer under the pit of despair, under the guilt of our sins, but instead to make haste to go to God today for the forgiveness that he gives. For with him there is forgiveness, says verse 4. With him there is plentiful redemption, says verse 7. And he is the one who will redeem Israel from all her iniquities, says verse 8. And this psalm, therefore, particularly as we come before the Lord's table, the burden of this psalm this morning is the burden of my heart. I want you to know, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that no matter what you've done, no matter how heinous and unspeakable, no matter how ruinous to your own life or injurious to the lives of others, there is forgiveness with God for you. I want you to know that if you have the heart to hate your sins because they displease God and to turn from them like a plague and live for God, that there is forgiveness with God for you. I want you to know that whether you don't know the first thing about being a Christian, or whether you've been a Christian for decades, if you find yourself this morning under the weight of sin's guilt and you know your only hope is in God's mercy, then there is forgiveness for you. I want you to leave here today convinced once and for all that the God of the Bible, the God of Christianity, is not only the only God, but a forgiving God who stands ready today to forgive you, period. No strings attached, no fine print, period. That, my dear friend, is the gospel. That's the good news. And maybe you're thinking, well, of course, we all know that. If it's not the center, at least it's the sum of the Christian message that God forgives sinners. Who doesn't know that? Who hasn't heard that? And you're right. One of the most universal and historical confessions of the Christian faith is the Apostles' Creed, in which all men all over the world that gather in Christ's church confess together, as we have already done this morning, I believe in the forgiveness of sins. Who hasn't heard the Apostles' Creed or said it? But let your own experience tell you how feebly you actually believe that. How many times have you been beset with doubts so strong that no amount of confessing could seem to bring peace to your guilty conscience? You kept going back again and again to the throne of grace, confessing the same thing, because you just didn't think it worked. You didn't think God actually really forgave you. How could he? How many times were you so overwhelmed by the guilt of conscience and the guilt and shame of what you had done that the only thing you believed, really, is that there was no way you could go to God and admit that? How many times have you been held back from confessing your sins to God because the condemning voice of the law, the accusing voice of the devil, and the guilt-ridden voice of your own heart all said to you in unison, God's not going to forgive you. Not this time, not again, not after that, not with how many times you have broken your word so far. How many times has even the preaching of God's grace in Christ found such unbelief in you that you walked away from the fountain of cleansing waters, still dragging your empty cup behind you? And how many times have you let people's refusal to forgive you lead you to believe that God also refuses to forgive you? Or people's requiring you to earn their forgiveness to lead you to believe that you have to earn God's forgiveness? Or because people have a way of forgiving you and yet still making you pay, lead you to believe that God's forgiveness is just the same? It's not even worth the Bible paper it's printed on. You see, men and churches are aplenty who confess this Christian truth. I believe in the forgiveness of sins. But I'm afraid there are few who actually know the comfort and enjoy the wonder of it all. I think we've lost the wonder of forgiveness. So this morning, I want to encourage your hearts on this matter in two ways. First of all, I want to give you three reasons why you have no basis ever to question God's willingness to forgive you again. And then secondly, by reminding you of the nature of God's forgiveness and why it is that it should put a song in your mouth every single day. First of all, this morning, diving right into this from verse 4. You can be sure that there's forgiveness with God because of the name by which he has revealed himself to us in Scripture. Look at Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7. You remember the context, I'm sure. Right after the golden calf in Exodus 32. So that in Exodus 34, when Israel was overwhelmed by the guilt of their sin in worshiping the golden calf, and Moses, you remember, was so distressed over the separation that the sin of Israel had caused between God and his people that he went immediately back up to Sinai to intercede for Israel and to beg God to have mercy. It was at that point that God graciously met with Moses, and he answered Moses' fears on the one hand and Israel's distress on the other by declaring his name. Moses, you remember, asked to see God's glory. God says, I'll tell you my name. I'll show you my goodness. And he declared his name. Do you remember what the name was in verse 6 and 7? The Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands of generations, forgiving sin, transgression, and iniquity. God was saying to the sin-burdened Israelite then, and he's saying still to you and me today, this is the name by which I want you to know me. When you need me, this is how you're to address me. When you sin, I'll answer to this. I'm the God of forgiveness. It's my name because it's my nature. I want you to call me by this because this is what I'll do for you. When we really blow it and we can hardly come to the throne of grace, and then when we find ourselves there, we don't know what to say. How can we draw near to God? How can we approach God? What can we say to him? How do we address him? God says, this is how. I am the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, abounding in steadfast love and kindness, the one who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin. Just call me by that name, and you'll find me there. Well might Israel have responded in Exodus 34 in amazement in the words of Micah 7, verse 18. Who is a God like you that pardons iniquity? Who has ever heard of such a God that forgives sins? As I said, my dear friends, this is still God's name today. Hebrews 13 says, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And in Malachi 3, the Lord himself says, I, the Lord, do not change. And so if you're here today and your sins are a problem to you, and your one desire is to be at peace with God, I want you to know that God still answers to this name. The Lord, a God merciful and gracious, abounding in love and forgiving sin. Secondly, this morning, you can be sure that there is forgiveness with God because he sent his son into the world to procure it. When God would prove to the world that he was a forgiving God, he sent his only son to procure it for us. John 3:16, of course, God so loved the world that he sent his only son into the world that whosoever believes in him shall not perish for their sins, but have everlasting life upon the forgiveness of their sins. Romans 4:25, Jesus Christ, Paul says, was delivered up to the cross for our sins. Romans 8:3, Jesus Christ, Paul says, came for sin. That is, to deal with sin, to deal with our sin. He came to put it all away by the sacrifice of himself on the cross, once and for all, in our place. Galatians 3:13 says Jesus was made a curse for us on that cross. On what ground? He was innocent. Because he bore our sins. And of course, Isaiah 53:6 puts it as plain as can be. God laid on him the iniquity of us all. And of course, this is the very basis then of God's forgiveness of us. The fact that Jesus died and paid the penalty for all those whom God forgives. In other words, we must never think of God's forgiveness as the turning of a blind eye. That's not what forgiveness is, beloved. God doesn't sweep a mess under the carpet and say, it's all good. We'll just pretend that didn't happen. That's not forgiveness. That's not how God forgives at all. When God forgives a sinner his sins, it's because Christ paid the penalty for those sins on the cross. You see, this is the nature of sin. When it goes out into the universe, its wages is death. You can't take it back. You can't undo it. And you can't change the result. It's done. It's happened. It will have its end. Somebody has to pay. Somebody's got to pay. It's either you or Christ. And the message of the gospel is just this. The Christ paid the price. He took full responsibility for our debt with God, and he paid it in full. That's what's behind the words, it is finished. It's paid. It's done. I did it, Father. Which is why 1 John says, if you confess your sins to God, he's not only faithful because he's promised, but he's just because Christ has paid to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You see, it's blasphemous to think that God would send his son to the cross to pay the penalty for our sins and then not forgive us those sins when we ask. Not even an earthly judge would do that. How much better the judge of all the earth who can only do right. So that one believing look at the cross of Jesus, where he died a cursed death, not for any sins of his own, but for the sins of all those who trust in him, one believing look at the hand of justice meting out the judgment we deserve. And we wonder how we could ever doubt the willingness of God to forgive us when we come to him, penitent. Do you remember Genesis 22? And I won't try to explain all of this. I'll leave it as it is. But do you remember Genesis 22 when God tested Abraham's faith by commanding him to offer up his only son Isaac on the altar? When Abraham made clear, as the story unfolds in that chapter, when Abraham made clear that he was willing to go through with it, and the Bible says the knife was above the child, God stopped him. And you remember what God said? God said, "Now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." Well, beloved, how much more is that true here? You see, God would have you look at the incarnation and the death of his son, in which he not only manifested a willingness, as Abraham did, to give up his son to secure your forgiveness, but in fact, he gave him up for you. Christ, you see, God raised the knife and lowered the knife in the heart of Christ. You see, God would have you look at the cross and say with the most unshakable of assurance, "Now I know that there is forgiveness with God, seeing that he did not withhold his son, his only son, from me." Thirdly, this morning, you can be sure there's forgiveness with God because he calls you to repentance. Now, don't miss this. You see, when the angels sinned and fell from heaven, God didn't call them to forgiveness because there was no forgiveness for them. There was no intention in God's heart to restore the angels. And so no gospel went out to them. Lucifer was never evangelized. The angels were never evangelized to win them back. And the same with all the damned in hell. No preacher will ever be sent to hell because there's no forgiveness for them. The door has been shut, as we heard in Sunday school this morning. They lie justly under God's wrath, and there's no intention in God's heart ever to forgive them. No gospel is ever going to be preached in hell. The time is up. But beloved, not so with you. Think about that. No matter what you've done compared with the angels or even with the damned, God has sent preachers to you. God has been pleased to have the gospel preached to you. God has had you called even now to repentance. What a mercy. And why is that? Why the difference between you and the angels or you and the damned? Because God would have you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that there is forgiveness in him for you. In other words, God wants you to take this personal. There is forgiveness for you. You fill in the name. Beloved, God is calling you to repentance because he stands ready with forgiveness. It's just that simple. That's the gospel. Why else would Jesus teach us in Matthew 6 to come to God in faith with the words, as we have already done this morning, "Forgive us our debts"? Unless the Father had it in his heart to grant the forgiveness we seek. Jesus says to us, "Pray this way," because this is exactly the way the Father answers. You see, there's simply no good reason at all why a man who hears the call of God to repent should question whether or not God will actually forgive him. The very fact that you hear the call and you have a heart to answer it is all the proof you need that God stands before you in a forgiving disposition. My dear friends, why would you sit still under the weight of your sins today? That's just the question, isn't it? Why would you go on mourning under a guilty conscience and languishing under the guilt and shame of sin when God is the God of forgiveness, the God being preached to you, the God held out to you in his own word, is the God who forgives sinners? Dear friends, he not only welcomes you, he commands you to come and get it. It's just that way. But if you're still in need of convincing today, then let me take a few minutes and tell you of the amazing nature of God's forgiveness and just what it is that he is holding out to you when he calls you away from your sins and into his arms. I want you to think about this. First of all, the forgiveness of God is an abundant forgiveness. In Mark 3:28, Jesus himself said, "All the sins of men shall be forgiven them." In Isaiah 1:18, the Lord says, though they be as red as scarlet and as dark as crimson, they'll be forgiven. And in 1 John 1:7, the apostle says, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. You see, it doesn't matter if your sins are more numerous than the hairs on your head, the stars in the heavens, the leaves in the forest, the blades of grass on the earth, the grains of sand on the world's shores, or all of that combined. It can all be forgiven and washed away by the atoning blood of Jesus Christ today. Do you believe that? I sure hope you do. Because it's the promise of a God who cannot lie. Go to him today with repentance in one hand and faith in the other, and that forgiveness is yours. Secondly, the forgiveness that God offers you today is a complete forgiveness. It's a pardon so complete that the minute you have it, you are counted before God as righteous as if you had never sinned. Just imagine that. All your sins are blotted out. Removed, says Psalm 103:12, as far as the east is from the west. No condemnation, says Romans 8:1, remains for you. The moment you believe, you receive. The Father sees you in and with his Son, and he accepts and he loves you just as he does him. You're a son now. You're a child. You're adopted into the family. And God knows no outcast. And the Son sees you as his beautiful bride without spot or blemish, and he lavishes you with the kisses and the embraces of his loving heart. How wonderful is this complete forgiveness? How great is it? How full and complete is it? But let me put it this way. If the cross of Christ had only left us one sin, take the tiniest you can think of, it doesn't matter. If it had left you only one sin to deal with before on your own before you got to heaven, beloved, we would all miss heaven and perish eternally. You can't even pay for one. You can't even deal with one. You can't even reconcile yourself to God for one, because to break one commandment is to break them all, because to break one commandment is to be a lawbreaker, and it is to come under the curse and the condemnation of God's law. You're done. It's over. That's it. You are categorically a sinner, condemned, cursed, and without hope and without God. If David or Daniel or Job had but one day's sins to wash away on their own, they'd never have been saved. But praise be to God, this is the message, beloved. The work of our Savior is so complete, so glorious, and so full that in the matter of our forgiveness, we have nothing left to do but to hold out an empty hand of faith and receive it. That's it. Take. You know the gospel well as I do. Isaiah is filled with it. Come, drink. Come without money and buy. Why will you waste your money on that which is not bread, that which is not satisfied? Come and let me give you real food, blessing for the soul. Beloved, do you believe that? Do you believe that God's forgiveness is so complete, so full? Or is the work of Christ so little to you and the glory of the Redeemer so small in your eyes that you still think in the back of your mind that there are some sins you need to pay for? Those really, really, really big ones. But God's forgiveness doesn't really cover all of that. Do you still think that there is forgiveness that you need to earn by doing good works or by loving God really well? Hear me when I say to you that that line of thinking is simply not in the book. It is not in the book. Rather, the good book says it as plain as day. Jesus came to save. Period. Not to take a swing at it. Not to add his good part, his large part to your little part. Not to enable you to save yourself and to set everything in motion and put you on the right road. But rather he came to save you himself, to do it all by himself so that he could get all the glory, because he won't share his glory with anybody. But so that you can get all the love, because that's what his heart is filled with. Overwhelming and overflowing with love for you. Listen again to his own words in John 6:47. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me has eternal life. There's simply no other way to read that, beloved. Thirdly, the forgiveness that God offers to you today is free and unconditional forgiveness. It's not burdened with an if. It's not hamstrung by a condition. It can't be bought with money. It doesn't stand by asking you to prove your worth, because grace can't be bought. Love can't be earned. If grace is bought, it's not grace. If love is earned, it's not love. In fact, the only character required of you is that you know yourself to be sinful and undeserving. You know yourself to be absolutely, utterly broke. In Revelation 22, 17, the Lord says, whoever will may take the water of life freely. Matthew 11, 28, Jesus said, if you're weary and heavy laden with the load of your sins, and you know if you are, then you're free to go to him for the rest of forgiveness, and he'll give it to you, just like that. That's what he does. So, dear friends, he really meant it when he said in Mark 2:17 that he came to call, not those who think themselves to be righteous and deserving and in need of nothing, no handout, but rather those who know themselves to be undeserving, helpless sinners in need of a whole Savior. If that's you today, if you know you're a sinner and you want a Savior, then go to Jesus just as a sinner that you are, and you will find him to be the Savior that you need. Fourthly, this morning, the forgiveness that God offers you is a tried forgiveness, and what an encouragement this is. Do you realize that millions and millions have sought forgiveness at the cross of Christ, and none has ever come back to say that he sought it in vain? Not one. Sinners of every name and nation, of every sort and description, have knocked at the door of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they have been answered with a full and a free pardon, just by sheer grace. We can name some of them. We can think of Zacchaeus the extortioner, Mary Magdalene the prostitute, Saul the persecutor, Peter the denier of his Lord, the Jews who crucified the Lord of glory, the idolatrous Athenians, the adulterous and homosexual Corinthians, and the list goes on. And I hope your name's on it. But they've all ventured their souls on Christ's promise of forgiveness. And they've all found exactly what they sought and much, much more. Now, if the way of forgiveness were a new and untraveled way, we might be nervous to be the first to step out on it. We might be nervous to be one of the few who should brave it. What if the bridge breaks? What if the boat sinks? But it's an old path. It's a very old path. It is a path worn by the feet of countless pilgrims. A path in which all the footsteps run the same way, and none have ever seen coming back. You see, because Christ's treasury has never been found empty, the well of living waters has never been found dry. Do you believe that? Do you believe that despite the millions in heaven already and the millions more enjoying God's forgiveness on earth right now, that there is still forgiveness for you? Then what are you waiting for? Go to God. Go to God today. Because finally, and best of all, the forgiveness that God offers to you in his Son, Jesus Christ, it's an everlasting forgiveness. Boy, if it wasn't, then what's the point? Because we're everlasting creatures. We need an everlasting forgiveness. And that's what God offers. I'm here to tell you this morning that God doesn't write with a pencil, beloved. God doesn't write with a pencil just in case it doesn't work out. Just in case those plans don't succeed. Just in case it's more work than it's worth. Imagine if God wrote with a pencil, beloved. Our names would be erased the very day they were inscribed. We are not worth it if it's about us. But God doesn't write with a pencil. Every name written into the Lamb's book of life is written with an iron pen, never to be erased. It's written with the blood of Christ, never to be forgotten. As the old song says, when he hung on that cross, your name was on his mind, if you will. But better than the song is Scripture itself. Listen to Isaiah 49, verses 15 and 16. The Lord says, can a woman forget her nursing child that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? We would say, of course not. But God says, even these may forget. In some circumstances, in distressing circumstances, in selfish circumstances, these may forget. Yet, he says, I will not forget you. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands with iron nails. Your walls are continually before me. And what does he say in Jeremiah 31:3? I have loved you with an everlasting love. Beloved, God hates divorce. God doesn't know divorce. Because the sins of God's children are said to be cast into the sea of forgetfulness, cast behind God's back, and remembered no more. That's how God forgives. Some people say we can be justified one year and condemned the next. Children of God's adoption one day and outcast the next. Saved by God and yet possibly finally lost. But I tell you again, such a line of thinking is not in the book. Instead, the unequivocal words of my Lord are simply this. I give my sheep eternal life and they will never perish. Christ doesn't mince words. He knows exactly what he says, and there's only one way to read that. As we heard in Sunday school this morning, I tell you again, get yourself into Christ today, dear friends, because when you do, you're in an ark so secure and so safe that you will never perish. And maybe you're thinking, well, what about the sins and backslidings of all my tomorrows? To which the Bible answers, God would have never saved you in the first place if he didn't account for all that too. God knew exactly how much work you would be. God knew how many times you would backslide. He knew how close you would get to the precipice of utter apostasy. He knew all your sins. He knew how many times you would become an idolater, an adulterer, and against him. He knew how many times you would forsake him, deny him, turn away from him, and say with others that you never knew him. He knew how many times you would complain that you were ever raised in a Christian home. How many times you would turn away from the baptism and the gospel that was preached to you and that you embraced. He knew it all long before you did. He knew the shame and the dishonor you would bring to him and his gospel. He knew the shame and dishonor that you would bring to your congregation and church. He knew all your sins because Christ knows all your sins by name and he paid for every single one. God knew it all. And before you ever came to yourself, mindful that there was more in your Father's house than could ever be wanted, he came to you to save you, knowing everything that you would do as his child and all the work you would be, the trouble you would be. God doesn't begin what he doesn't intend to finish. And he knows the end from the beginning. The Lord doesn't do work by halves or fits and starts. Paul says what he began, he finishes. God says, let there be, and there is. It's just like that. Get God's forgiveness today, and it'll be yours forever. You see, because he sent Christ to die for all your sins, those of yesterday, those of today, and those of all your tomorrows, which is what makes his forgiveness so amazing. Because when God forgives, he forgives all your sins, and he brings you into an eternal fellowship and communion with himself, from which he has never, ever, ever written a certificate of divorce to a single soul. God doesn't know divorce, beloved. When Israel thought they were abandoned by God and cried out, and the nation says, where is your God? God's response was, where's your certificate of divorce? I've never written one, and I never will. That's the kind of God he is. once his, always his, beloved. Not because of what you do to stay in that relationship. There's no hope if it's on you. But because of what he has done to keep you in that relationship. Because it's not you who hold him. It's he who holds you. That's the gospel. It's God's grip on you that's so great. Yours on him is slippery. It's grace, beloved. It's all grace and it's nothing but grace. If you know that today, then I pray to God that you do. I pray that you'll never lose the wonder of it. I pray you'll always look on God's forgiveness of your sins with the sheer awe and wonder and joy of a child whose dreams have all just come true. Because forgiveness is the greatest blessing a soul can ever have. Because it covers everything and it lasts forever. And without it, you've got nothing. And with it, you've got everything. I'll close with two comments this morning. First of all, wherever you are today, whatever you're guilty of, whatever shame and guilt you're under, God is willing, God is able, and God is ready to forgive you. That's his promise. If you'll but confess your sins to him and sincerely desire in your heart that with his help you will turn from your sins and live for him, then the forgiveness I've spoken of today will be yours, free, full, and forever. Don't doubt. Don't let your shame keep you from coming to God. Own your sins to God, and he will own his mercy to you. That's his promise, not mine. That's his. But also, secondly, you've heard today, all of you indeed have heard today, that there is forgiveness with God for you. And your own conscience tells you, I hope, that you need it. And you've also heard that there is nothing that you need to do but receive it. Ask, says the Lord himself, and you shall receive. So if you leave this place today, and out of a love for your sins or the power of your unbelief, you refuse to repent and seek God's forgiveness, then, dear friend, your condemnation at the day of judgment will be just. Because on the day of judgment, you will be reminded of this day. You will be reminded of this sermon. You'll be reminded of this day and of the kindness of God to freely and graciously call you to come and receive his forgiveness. And you'll also be reminded of your refusal to do so, to put it off for another day. Yes, but not now. Maybe, but later. And maybe you don't feel your need for forgiveness today. So be it. But there may yet come a time that you will. And I pray to God that when you do, it won't be too late. Because it can be too late, though you live on many years in this world. Live on a hardened soul, lost on the path you chose. May you hear God's cry today, the call of the gospel, Jesus' own words, to come and receive. The gospel is the most wonderful thing you'll ever hear. It doesn't get any better than this. And when you have Christ and you have his grace, you don't need anything else. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God in heaven, we thank you for the good news of Jesus. Thank you, O God, that you have been pleased to not leave us in the sinful condition into which we cast ourselves. For we have ruined ourselves, Lord. But we thank you that you brought the gospel to us. Thank you that we have come to know it, Lord, those of us who know it. But we thank you that today you have been full of mercy to have the gospel preached in the hearing of all. Lord, we pray that this word has come to every heart. In mercy, Father, may you seek the prodigals. May you go to the lost. Cause those who do not know you to come to themselves. Work in them by your Spirit that faith and repentance that is necessary for salvation. And we pray that you would draw every soul to yourself. And those who know you today and rest in your forgiveness and grace, Father, we pray that you would increase their comfort and encouragement. Pray that they will grow today in their wonder of forgiveness, and they will no longer count the forgiveness of their sins to be such a small thing, but they will consider it the greatest thing ever, the best news they've ever heard. May they sing about it, may they praise you for it, may they testify to it by not just their lips, but their lives. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.